So the problem for the research, where we now, at this moment, it's no mouse model to study the disease, and it's no gene mutation has been well identified, and also only thing to treatment is the surgical procedures. So we built a program, we try to understand indeed from differentiation of the, if you try to understand the smooth muscle cell determination and differentiation, there's already known in the community the aorta, the different parts of the aorta has come from different progenitor cells. So if we and others in the field is able to develop different and progenitor cells and driving the different differentiation of the different part of aorta, we might probably have a IPS model to study the disease and mimic the human situation. So that's well known in the field. What we did at the University of Michigan, we used the human patient sample and we developed the methods. We're able to drive the neurocrystal stem cells for ascending aorta, and that's where we are. We use the patient-specific remodeling, try to understand the different and parts of the biology where the cells come from. And then we have a platform where we do and get almost 100 different patients and iPS cells. We started to make them, we use this platform to try to understand. And then we, in collaboration with the bioengineer people at the University of Michigan, we're doing and try to make a tissue engineering, make biodegradable and a scaffold, and try to develop and patient specific and muscles for. And then we have, as I mentioned at the beginning, we have a large animal model, we have implant to a large animal model. So the way we believe it's for us, we need 3 hours. One way is you have to understand the mechanism, where the cells, how the determination, how the differentiation. So that's the regeneration part. We have to working with the bioengineer people to do with construction and also working with the cardiac surgeons to do and repair. So the study is given by 3 groups, and Bo Yang is a cardiac surgeon and trained in Stanford, will likely report it to University of Michigan. Peter was trained by Bob Langer 20 years ago. There's the people and back to 20 years ago in Bob Langer's lab, they do all of the, at that time, it's far more before the tissue engineer right now, they use different material to do a vascular replacement, which right now in the clinical practice, we still use whatever they invented 20 years ago from Bob Long's lab. So that's, we're lucky, and Peter has been in Michigan almost 20 years as a faculty over there. We formed a team of us, we're doing whatever described here. Thank you for the opportunity.
Okay, thanks. Questions?
So, what's the defect in a bypass of the valve? Is it because of turbulent flow from the valve? Is that why it's in the ascending aorta, or is it due to actual defects in the smooth muscle of the aorta?
So, to study right now, we discovered more on the smooth muscle cell biology. When we use a patient-specific iPS cells from the patients, we're able to identify some of the mechanism that's quite different from the control than normal people biology. For sure, you know, the shear stress is also contributed.
Could I follow up with that?
Yeah, sure.
So you have an elegant study where you're taking reprogramming samples of patients that have aortic aneurysms and bicuspid valves and controls, and you suggest that you see differences in your engineered vessels.
we at this stage we see the difference in the determination differentiation. So we haven't gone that far to see the vascular engineered tissue difference. We see a huge difference when the disease and drive iPS cell when differentiation to different and progenitor cells. But we see no difference if they go for the ascending progenitor cells to do a differentiation from patients, and they do the difference is in the ascending and progenitor cells.
Your protocol for neural crest differentiation from iPS cells, how do you characterize the that they're neural crest? What is your...
Yes, that's a publish. That's a paper published, and if you're interested, I can send you the details. Okay. Yeah.
Just a practical question.
Yes.
What's the time frame and the cost to do a knock-in and a paper?
That's good questions. So that's for a knock-in, I don't know. I will never do a knock-in the peaks, but we do a knock-out. So
how long about that? How long does it take given the gestation time, and how much does it cost?
We have to go on a case by case. We can discuss that when you have time for your truly interest.
How about collaboration you will do for you and what
you can do? The peak, it's cost too much. I don't have that much resource for collaboration. We really have to. Most of them are pharmaceutical at this moment. The rapid module, if you want to do collaboration, we maybe have the resource. The peak ones, we really have to find a resource to cover.
The Randy Prater will make a pay for it. Well, he'll do it, whether it's fee for service. He runs the NIH National Swine Resource Center down in Missouri. And so, if it's of interest, you know, it goes into a queue, and it'll take, I think the queue is as long as maybe 6 months, but they'll engineer that.
Do they do CRISPR or yes,
CRISPR-Cas9, and the gestation period is about 114 days.
Right.
So it's a little bit longer, but everything has to be cloned. There's no ES cells, and so once you engineer that. If you want to continue to propagate it, you got to reclone it.
Do they just do it on fertilized, basically on zygotes rather than ES cells, just like CRISPR
no,
the mouse?
No, they do it in fibroblasts, right? They take fibroblasts, they gene edit them, knock in or knock out, and then they'll have to clone those.
That's some say 5 years ago. Right now, it's not that way. So right now, you just inject the quick design and a CRISPR snap and design you do on the injections, pretty much like you do in the mouse model.
I know, but in the mouse model you do it on a fertilized egg directly, just like a transgenic, and then you don't have to wait for the germline. So we can talk more
about
that.
Okay, we better move on to our next talk. Rick Kitsis is here from Albert Einstein.
So I'm listed as a PCBC investigator, but to be honest, I had an ancillary grant with Joe Wu that supported some of this work on small molecule, anti-cell death small molecules that we've discovered. And I really had to read up on this to talk about that. We're not actively working on anything having to do with stem cells. So you guys know a lot more about this than I do. But it's obviously incredibly important. So this is from a review that Victor Zhao wrote about 2 months ago. It was in Scope Research. Typical Victor review. He gets right to the point, and he goes through it, and it's very deeply referenced. And he made a couple of points about paracrine factors, which you guys think about every day. The most important is they're pleiotropic. They're not just doing one thing. I'm going to end this talk with cell death, because that's what I work on. But these factors are affecting many different processes that I'll show on the next slide. And two examples are this secreted Frizzled protein, which antagonizes WNT3A, that he has worked on, which basically has effects on beta-catenin signaling and inhibiting cell death. But then look at that next to the HASF, which is just an open reading frame that he renamed, I think it's hypoxia AKT-stimulated factor, which is basically affecting both proliferation and inhibiting cell death. So there's things that are inhibiting flux of the actual and you can see that some of these same factors, for example, the Frizzle factor, is involved with promoting differentiation genes and affecting proliferation genes also. So in the next slide, and this is, again, not something I'm really expert on, but it's in this review, he has this nice little chart of a whole bunch of the factors that have been studied and what they affect on the horizontal axis, including survival, proliferation, some immune modulation, which in his case, mostly he's talking about chemokines, so not innate immunity, if you read that article. And then kind of downstream effects like remodeling and contractility. Okay, so I want to, I guess, pose the issue in the most broad sense, which is not just about survival, but it's about these factors. Now, how much in this community stem cells are thought to work through paracrine effects versus direct effects? I don't really know what the thinking is on that right now. Maybe that's something that can come up in the discussion. I mean, to read the article, you would think that most of the effects are paracrine effects, and I don't think everybody believes that completely, but you guys, this is an engineering conference, so there must be some mechanical thing involved. But let's focus in. The second thing I was supposed to introduce for discussion was cell death, and well, the point I want to make in this slide is that cell death is not just about apoptosis. There are, if you read classifications of cell death that appear in Cell Death and Differentiation every couple of years, they list like 19 forms of cell death. I think it's ridiculous because I think a lot of them are not molecularly distinct from each other. But even if we just restrict this to apoptosis and necrosis, which have major league differences in terms of maintaining plasma membrane integrity and releasing cellular contents into the extracellular space in necrosis versus containing it in apoptosis, the major difference being collateral damage in necrosis, because it's not so much exposure of self that now the immune system can recognize. That is a factor, but the major factor is this pro-inflammatory cytokines that actually get released in necrosis that engender this whole tissue response. So I'm not showing pictures of this because I know you're very aware of what a myocardial infarction looks like with all the damage, as opposed to a mammary gland that regresses after suckling, which there's almost no evidence that cell death has taken place. It's just stealth cell death. And the pathways that mediate these are different. Both of them have a death receptor component, and they have a component that involves mitochondria. The sine qua non of this is caspase activation through different mechanisms. And this is the necroptosis pathway that you hear a lot about. I realize if you're not thinking about these things daily, you probably don't even care about this, but this is basically a pathway mediated by RIP1, RIP3 kinase, and a pseudokinase called mixed lineage kinase glycan 1. Whereas this is the necrosis pathway that people think about as cardiologists, which is mitochondrial mediated necrosis. It's due to opening of a pore on the inner membrane rather than permeabilization of the outer membrane of mitochondria. And I'm talking black and white on these things with some gray in between. And I can make these slides available if anybody will. This is the slide I drew, but it's kind of 30,000 foot view. Okay, so how can you manipulate these pathways? So I decided that in the last couple slides, I'll talk about some stuff that's published and some stuff that's not published. And this is basically more geared toward our interest in myocardial infarction and wanting to make them smaller. There are two approaches to drug discovery. One is to basically take unbiased approaches like a geneticist would do a screen, and the other is to take a candidate approach. There's advantages and disadvantages to both. With the high throughput screening, it's basically let the best molecule win, and you're going to basically not put your money down on any particular target. That's the advantage. The disadvantage is you have to figure out what the cellular target is. Not so easy. It's not like doing an IP on a protein and seeing what it interacts with. Generally, what people do is they chemically modify the protein, usually with a reactive group that will form a covalent bond with target. And usually it's done in an inducible way. So a diazerine group, which is an N triple bond N, is used to basically, those free electrons in that nitrogen can basically form a covalent bond with substrate, because often these interactions are very weak. And then you try to pull down the small molecule with another tag you placed on it, like a biotin. and try to do mass spec on the things you pull down. So in theory, it's very simple. In practice, it's very challenging, and there are issues involving bias, which I won't get into. Okay, so that's the unbiased approach. The candidate approach is if you've validated a target that you think is truly rate-limiting, okay, in the real model of the disease, because if it's not, you're basically wasting your time. And this is what academics generally do. They have a target for disease, but when it gets to pharma and they start to put it into real models, that's why I was asking about large models to knock things out in, as opposed to mouse models, you can often mislead yourself. So here's examples of the two of them. This first one's been published, but we did a screen of the NIH library, which is about 360,000 compounds, using HL1 or H9C2 cells. Now you know as well as I, H9C2 cells are a totally lousy cardiomyocyte system. They look like skeletal muscle cells, or fibroblasts in some situations. But we did them because we had them. We also used HL1 cells, which are T-antigen-transformed cardiomyocytes. Two stimuli, oxidative stress with hydrogen peroxide, metabolic stress with 2-deoxyglucose. So you can immediately say, why would you use a glycolytic inhibitor if you're interested in studying ischemic damage, which is mainly oxidative phosphorylation? All of the drugs are too toxic to use in a robotic-based type of screen. And ATP is the readout for live death. And so I don't want to run through this whole thing, but using some orthogonal screens, you can come up with a small number of hits that are basically protective. And some of these turned out to not be blocking cell death. They turned out to be affecting metabolism, as you'd expect, because ATP was the screen. The hit rate on survival in all the cell death assays that have been done in different tissues is about 0.3%. So if you start off with 470,000, you can multiply it by 0.3% and get the number. Now, while this was in progress, my lab happened to discover that BACs mediates not only, this was known for a long time, cytochrome C release. So what happens with BACs is it's regulated mainly conformationally. It gets activated when it's bound by a so-called BH3-only protein, like BIM or TBIG. And it's very well understood what the rearrangements are. The major structural change is the 9th alpha helix is exposed. It allows BACs to translocate to the membrane, insert, it oligomerizes in the membrane, and it may form a pore. That's a conclusion that was drawn from liposomes. But it somehow permeabilizes this membrane to let apoptogens out that trigger apoptosis. What we found is, and Jeff Bokenstein confirmed this a year or so later, is that BACs also potentiates necrosis. And it does it through mechanisms that have not yet been, we haven't agreed what's really going on. We think it's driving mitochondrial fusion. And the fact that it's keeping these mitochondria fused are somehow creating an environment that predisposes to opening up of this pore. Jeff thinks it's actually in complex with that. They both could be right. The two models may not be separate. This pore, by the way, turns out is probably the F0, F1 ATPase itself, which is a huge surprise that the mitochondrial permeability transition pore would be that. So I had some structural slides in here, but I actually took them out because I didn't feel like I could put them on the website right now. But it shows that the compound you're looking at here binds directly to BACs to an unrecognized surface on BACs that hasn't been characterized yet and inhibits BACs activation. And the result in adult cardiomyocytes, if we look at, this is 1 hour of hypoxia, 3 hours of deoxygenation, is to preserve this. And when you use this, we basically have gone through iterations of this using structure-based approaches to refine the drug. We now have something that will work in vivo to block BACs activation, and what we really want to do is see if this works in large animals. So here's some jumping off points that how this might be relevant to what we think talking about here. First, the overriding theme of cell death in this field is survival of transplanted cells. Most of the cells die. That's the whole basis of the paracrine hypothesis to begin with. Capitalizing on the pleiotropic effects of paracrine effects, I was thinking about that when I wrote this slide. How could you pick things that would do more than one thing, not just block cells out? But I think number three is actually, a lot of you are not interested in transplanting cells. You're interested in endogenous differentiation programs. So I actually think from a basic biological point of view, the roles of cell death and lineage determination. So I'm in a department where half the department's working on hematopoietic stem cell development and epigenetics, and they're always, you know, that schema that they always put up with the multipotent
cell, and then the multipotent, the one that goes to the red cells and the, you know, the one. Okay, so apoptosis of some populations versus another is something that's a major factor in that. So that would be kind of an indirect effect. But there's also these non-cell death functions of cell death molecules. And I think you're aware of Tom Zawaka's paper of caspase activation cleaving mannan possibly being a mechanism of ES cell differentiation. And this is true in a lot of different paradigms. Skeletal muscle development, caspases somehow get activated and are important in development. So I'm going to stop there and see if there's, you know, discussion points that are more precise to what you'd be interested in.
Thanks, Rick. That's great. Questions?
That's great. I have a philosophical, silly philosophical question. So my understanding about the difference between necrosis and apoptosis is that one of them is designed to not harm the milieu of dying cell by exploding and releasing the cellular body environment and such. And the other was in my teaching was an unregulated process. So why would you want to have a regulated pathway that will make the cell explode?
Yeah, that's a really good question, and one that I always get asked when I teach this stuff. What's the purpose of apoptosis? I don't have an answer, but I'll tell you a hypothesis. I think this is related to the most fundamental things that multicellular organisms have to deal with. Keep out infections and don't get traumatized, because those are the two things that are going to kill you. And I believe this is related to basically a fibrotic response that you need to have in order to have wound healing. We were talking about earlier when you would block the scar during myocardial infarction. You wouldn't want to block it in the first 7 days. But if those Tregs didn't come in later and damp it down, you'd end up with a stellar heart. So I think in this case, the more primitive thing, when you're not worrying about heart disease that doesn't even happen if you don't live to age 20, is basically hemostasis and protection against the outside environment, things getting in, hence forming a scar. That's a guess. If you trace the genes back, you kind of lose necrosis genes around, so C. elegans is 600 million years, and 800 million years would be like dictyostelium. You start to lose being able to trace the actual genes themselves, like cyclophobin D, RIP1, RIP3 kinase at that point. So the two aren't that different in terms of their time frame, 600 to 800 million years. Yes, Gerald.
I'd just like to chime in. I think it's probably less accurate to say that apoptosis is a clean way to die, necrosis is a dirty way to die. Because in the heart, both of them give you, when the myocyte drops out, it's replaced by fibrosis. So in the heart, apoptosis is not a clean way to die. Apoptosis is energy requiring, and necrosis is not. And many times, the two processes are ongoing simultaneously, and as long as you can. As you're able to generate sufficient ATP to drive apoptosis, you get an apoptotic response. And then when you run out of that metabolic substrate, or water, the damage is so great, then it goes ahead and shifts over to necrosis. And that's, I think that's probably the fundamental difference right now, is whether or not you can drive the cleaner process with having endogenous energy.
Maybe I could ask
Francesco
to transition a little. You mentioned about cell death and development differentiation. And so for some of these protocols and approaches to get various lineages in a dish, how do you envision manipulating cell death pathways that could be advantageous for the process?
So I mean, it really depends on what's known about those decision points. Do you know enough right now about how a multipotent cell, I'm just analogizing back to blood, will make a decision where, or in the brain, for example, where this degree, these groups of neurons will drop out because they're not getting NGF to innervate them, to feed back, so they're gone. 50% of the cells in the brain die. Can you draw that type of a schematic diagram with respect to cardiogenesis or cardiopoiesis?
I think you identify a big area that there's a gap in knowledge. At least for me, it's a pretty big gap in knowledge what happens. But clearly, there are conditions where you grow and differentiate the cell, that there's large amounts of cell death. You change the medium, those are gone, and you move on. But when and how that occurs and how you might be able to take advantage of that. I think it's an interesting area.
I mean, what would be really cool is if there was even one decision point where the default was cell death and the other was going down the pathway, to try to understand how whatever transcription factors you decide are important here, how they're making that. Maybe there's like a cell intrinsic program here, and maybe the secreted factors that then go out. It could be one of any number of things. I'd really love to work on that if that type of landscape is worked out. Yeah.
In skeletal muscle literature, there have been studies showing how apoptosis actually is an intermediate path to de-differentiation of muscle cells.
Atrophy? Because I didn't know about this. Yeah. This is when they undergo atrophy?
Yeah. And when they basically go from a multinucleated myotubes into almost a generation of single cells and de-differentiation. And so, you know, if anything like that, maybe.
I'm learning right now that this even happens. So what situation does this happen in?
Injury.
So you injure a muscle and it goes from they break down into individual.
They break down, but there is an intermediate step of apoptosis. Caspases are all activated, and there is a stage of de-differentiation. These cells can actually transit the nuclei, and then rebuild the muscle.
Do you end up with the same number of nuclei you started with? Is there actually any cell death, or is it just basically a deconstruction of the myotube?
It's a paper, I cannot remember that.
I'd like to read that.
Yes, I can send it.
Yes.
Just a quick follow-on to that. It's kind of interesting because in that context, it's called muscle. Phi-1 has got to play a role in fusion after that proliferative process. And it's the exposure, it's a phosphatidyl binding protein, so the exposure of the apoptotic cells that actually let the signal through Phi-1 promote fusion, sort of unrelated to apoptosis in that case. But sort of an aside, I'm not sure how they all come together, but Phi-1 has been studied in that case.
Yes.
That was really entertaining talk. Thanks. What I was thinking as you were talking about it is we have this Goldilocks zone for activation of the native immunity, and some activation of the native immunity seems to be important for epigenetic plasticity, but excessive activation of the native immunity causes constraints on that epigenetic plasticity. I'm just wondering if some of what you told us today is kind of role in epigenetic constraints. This cell death pathways. You said there's other data that for example, caspase is involved in activation. I think you said.
Actually, it cleaves neurons so that it can't retro-differentiate back.
Okay, so that's consistent then. The cell death pathway being.
Right. And I don't think there's death. I think it's caspase activation without cell death.
Right.
That's what Zerwachmann is saying. Which actually, there's another guy, walking on his name, but at the University of at McMaster or Hamilton, caspases can get activated without killing the cell.
Right.
And whether there's some sort of shielding molecules that block their substrates from being cleaved, or you know, they somehow have specificity for one thing but not others. But getting back to your question, in your model, if I understood correctly, oxidative stress would cause the epigenetic.
Oxidative stress, nitrosative stress enhances epigenetic plasticity up to a point. But at some point, excessive activation of the native immunity, excessive activation of the osteoarthritis impair epigenetic plasticity. Well, without causing cell death, before cell death occurs, you have a constrained cell that is no longer capable of becoming an IPS, no longer capable of becoming.
So maybe it's the oxidative stress is upstream of both this epigenetic plasticity and it's a stimulus for cell death. They could be parallel processes, not necessarily sequential processes. But I wasn't unaware of this plasticity until I heard your talk, so it's definitely something to think about.
Okay, we probably better move on. Thanks, Rick.
Yes.
So next, Suman Prabhu here from UAB will present.
Yeah, so I want to thank Jay for inviting me to present some data. You know, our field is heart-to-heart cardiac remodeling, and our view of cell therapy is informed by this whole the studies I'm just going to share with you, and I apologize, I have a few more slides, I'll go through them. But it really stems from a collaboration that we have with Roberto Boli as part of the program project plan, looking really at these lineage negative c-kit positive cells, cardiac stem cells, and its use in cardiac cell therapy. And our interest really stems from a longstanding interest in inflammation. And the reason that we undertook these studies was based on this data from Kubo, Hauser, the group in Temple, that showed that if you look at patients who have heart failure, we actually have an increased number of these c-kit positive CSCs, both quantitatively in absolute numbers as well as percentage basis for the number of mononuclear cells. And yet, the remodeling in failing heart progresses, the heart gets worse. But if you take these cells out and put them in co-culture with the neonatal rat particular myocytes, you will see formation of cardiomyocytes. So it seems that there's a deficit, a differentiation block, perhaps in vivo, that can be overcome if these cells are isolated and removed. And so it suggested that to us, a deficient endogenous repair is really not secondary to depletion of the overall stem cell pool. And the real ultimate question is, why doesn't the injured heart heal itself to a better degree than we see clinically? And as a heart failure cardiologist, this is really the key aspect of the so-called myocardial recovery field. So we've been interested in cytokines for a long time and inflammation and heart failure, and this is the so-called cytokine hypothesis of heart failure, that we all know very well that heart failure is a chronic inflammatory state. There are elevated levels of these inflammatory mediators. And the foundation cytokine is really a tumor necrosis factor. And these have been shown in multiple studies to have detrimental effects on cardiac function, reduction of fibrosis, pathologic hypertrophy, apoptosis, many of the same events that have been discussed this morning. And this is just to show you that as disease progresses, levels of tumor necrosis factor, both in the serum and in the myocardial tissue, regardless of the etiology of the cardiomyopathy, increases significantly. So when we talk about cell therapy delivered to failing hearts or infarcted hearts, this is an inflammatorily harsh environment where there is elevated levels of multiple pro-inflammatory mediators. So we had this hypothesis that this is one of the factors that impairs endogenous CSC function in failing heart. And we wanted to look specifically at TNF and the effect of TNF through its two receptors on the therapeutic efficacy of CSCs. This is just a schematic of the signaling with TNF. And there's two receptors, R1 and R2, and really three downstream signaling pathways that include many of the things that were discussed earlier with the innate immune pathways, activation of NF-kappa-B as well as junk and MAP kinase. And one of the things to realize is that these receptors have preferential interactions with different forms of TNF. So TNF receptor 1 preferentially is activated by soluble TNF, whereas TNF receptor 2, differentially activated by membrane TNF, and this implies the proximity of immune cells where membrane TNF is expressed in the environment. So we looked at TNF signaling activity. We had c-kit sorted lineage negative CSCs that were isolated from Roberto Boli's lab, from wild type TNFR1 and TNFR2 knockout mice. And then we examine these cells in detail. This is just showing in an early passage that there's expression. One of the things that we noticed is if you passage these cells, you lose c-kit expression. And these cells primarily, at later passages, have lost c-kit and primarily express SCA1. And this is something that has been shown in other studies, and this is in contrast to human and pig c-kit CSCs. This is just to show that TNF signaling is quite active in the CSCs. Some take-home points here is that TNF receptor 1 is constitutively expressed. TNF receptor 2 is not, but it's inducible by stress, such as mechanical stress, which we would see in the failing heart. The NF-kappa-B pathway is quite active with TNF stimulation. It's primarily P65s. And then if we look at wild-type receptor 1 knockout, receptor 2 knockout CSCs, the P38, junk, And NF-kappa B pathways are all activated in wild-type CSCs, but they're not activated at all in TNF receptor 1 knockouts. They are present in TNF receptor 2. So constitutively, primarily the signaling for TNF is for TNF receptor 1. We next looked at differentiation of these cells using a protocol by Smits et al. In Nature Protocols 2009. This is really geared towards human cardiomyocyte progenitors. And this is based on 5-azacitidine, growth factors of TGF-beta, and ascorbic acid at various time points, a 28-day protocol. So if we take these urine c-kit positive CSCs and follow them out with this protocol, we'll see that these cells flatten. They look more like neonatal cardiomyocytes. They have binucleation, and by day 28, there's several cells there. And if we stain, we see that there's ample amounts of cardiac actin, and suggesting a cardiomyocyte-like differentiation of these stem cells. Well, if you then expose these cells concomitantly to TNF, what we see is that the morphology of these cells is quite different. And they have dendritic-like projections, very prominent, especially at later stages of differentiation. This is a closer-up view, and these cells look terribly abnormal, almost with neuronal-type morphology. And this effect was, I don't have GFP labeled cells here, but this is just the phase contrast microscopy showing that that morphologic change is really dependent on the presence of both TNF receptors during this differentiation process. So that if we give TNF concomitantly during that differentiation protocol, these cells are flattened without what we see in wild type CPCs. If we look at gene expression, a couple of things that stand out. If we look at cardiomyogenic genes, MF2C, NKX2.5 beta myosin heavy chain, in general, unopposed TNF receptor 1 activation tends to reduce the expression of these cardiomyogenic gene markers. And whereas if you look at smooth muscle cell, smooth muscle actin, or FLK1 for endothelial cells, the loss of TNF receptor 1 decreases the amount of smooth muscle cell in the endothelial phase, or at least gene expression. So what occurs is that TNF receptor 1 signaling restrains cardiomyogenic differentiation but promotes smooth muscle cell and endothelial cell differentiation. So since these had a neuronal phenotype, we also looked at tyrosine hydroxylase, which is the regular next step in catecholamine synthesis. We found that TNF really increases significantly TH expression, and that this is really requires both TNF receptor 1 and receptor 2. And this was paralleled by an increase in epinephrine secretion in the supernatant, which was lost with deletion of either TNF receptor 1 or receptor 2. So we had this interesting notion that TNF and perhaps other inflammatory mediators present in vivo really promotes an alternate neuroadrenergic fate and blocks cardiomyogenic differentiation. And this is just to show immunostaining with TNF expression. With differentiation, we'll see tyrosine hydroxylase primarily perinuclear. Here it's much more diffuse and present in these dendritic or type projections. Well, that's all well and good. But this was important to us because this suggested a new source of adrenergic activation in the failing heart. That is, that it's well known that heart failure is a catecholamine-rich, adrenergically activated state. What this is suggesting is that due to high levels of TNF in this case, or perhaps other inflammatory mediators, endogenous resident CSCs are perhaps one source of high levels of catecholamines in heart failure. And the flip side is that if we give cell therapy, what is to prevent these delivered cells to develop similar alternate fates in myocardium and actually reduce the efficacy of cell therapy. So to these cells, wild-type receptor 1 or receptor knockout cells, and performed, come back, performed in vivo cell therapy studies in a reperfused MI model. The cells were given 48 hours after myocardial infarction, and the animals were followed for 35 days after cell therapy, and we gave four equivalent 25,000 cells per injection in four sites in the border zone of the infarct. And this is just showing, if the video would work, that we have large MI in the development of LV dysfunction at 35 days. So these are representative sections. You can see the large dilated heart scar here. Heart is a bit smaller in wild-type stem cell-injected hearts, perhaps smaller still in receptor 1 knockout CSC-injected hearts, whereas that effect is somewhat lost in the TNF receptor 2 knockout-injected hearts. Obviously, there's a lot of variability with infarct size, et cetera, so we show you the group data here for end-diastolic volume and systolic volume LV ejection fraction. So with vehicle-treated hearts, we see LV dilatation, both end-diastolic and systolic, and drop in ejection fraction. We improve volumes with either wild-type or TNF receptor 1 knockout stem cells and improve ejection fraction. But this effect is lost with TNF receptor 2 knockout. So unopposed TNF receptor 1 stimulation tends to reduce the efficacy, at least in vivo cell therapy. And two of the outcomes that we would like to see is a reduction in pathological hypertrophy in the remodeled treated heart and a reduction in fibrosis. So these are showing you that the same effects occur if we look at weak German gluten staining. You see the pathological hypertrophy of myocytes here. While either wild-type or receptor 1 CSC-injected hearts, we see a reduction in myocyte area. But this effect is really lost with receptor 2 knockouts. And we see a similar pattern with fibrosis. And indeed, if you look at just the receptor 2 knockout CSCs, we see an increase in fibrosis even over a vehicle-treated heart. So inflammatory modulation is key to the therapeutic efficacy of these cells in this murine model. And we think that there's a very significant impact of TNF on these cells, which is increased in the ambient milieu in the microenvironment. We also have data showing that there's greater cell persistence. These were male cells injected into female hearts, so we had a greater SRY copy number. And this is showing other hemodynamic and mechanical data, showing the receptor 1 knockout CSCs improved scar thickness and improved mechanical function. So one of the things that we also wanted to see was whether or not this neuroadrenergic effect occurred when we transplanted CSCs. And this is a 35 days post-injection. And you'll see these are GFP-positive CSCs. You'll see that there's co-staining between for tyrosine hydroxylase and GFP in the border zone. And if you look at the overall expression, or the overall abundance of tyrosine hydroxylase positive cells, this is markedly reduced when you have TNF receptor 1 knockout cells injected or transplanted into the border zones of these hearts. And we confirmed that in global knockouts, the heart failure, if you have receptor 2 knockout animals, heart failure, we also see an increase in tyrosine hydroxylase. So if we want to just summarize here, we think that there's a inflammatory microenvironment in heart failure, or perhaps with myocardial infarction, is a major obstacle to the efficacy and differentiation capacity of both endogenous cells as well as any kind of cell therapy that is exogenously administered. So, in under normal conditions, these resident stem cells primarily express TNF receptor 1. But there's not a lot of ambient soluble TNF floating around. So we have perhaps a slow repopulation of these cell types in the myocardium. When we have an inflamed environment, we not only have now TNF receptor 2 expressed during stress, we also have the influx of immune and inflammatory cells that express membrane-bound TNF that can interact now with a more comprehensive profile of TNF signaling. And this leads to a block in cardiomyocyte differentiation, an increase perhaps in endothelial cells from muscle cells, and perhaps the most intriguing part is this stimulation of a catecholamine-producing cell type in the myocardium. So what we would take from this is that elevated local systemic levels of soluble TNF, and this may be expandable to other pro-inflammatory mediators, significantly impair the efficacy of self-therapy. And that if you alter CSC fate by TNF, may be a novel source of adverse activation. And if we can clamp down TNF signaling or TNF receptor 1 signaling, we can augment the capacity for cardiac repair. And this indicates either circumscribed TNF blockade, and remember that post-infarct TNF receptor 1 expression is predominant, or perhaps a small molecule TNF receptor 1 blockade could be an important adjunct to any kind of cell therapy that we want. We want to be able to withstand the harsh microenvironment of the hearts that we are trying to treat. So with that, I'll stop and just thank all the collaborators, including collaborators at the University of Louisville. Happy to take any questions.
All right. Thanks so much. Time for one question.
That was really interesting. I think that my perspective is that the TNF-alpha activation is not per se causing noradrenergic transformation, but it's increasing epigenetic plasticity so that you can get noradrenergic transformation. And there must be something else in the environment of the cell, something else in your cell culture that is providing the cues. Because you need some directionality. TNF itself is not providing the prescriptional directionality for a neural cell. There must be something else.
I agree with you. Because this is a long-term differentiation protocol. So there has to be that. Because we're actually doing RNA RC on the two different genotypes. And we are looking at four, exactly what you were talking about, which are epigenetic changes in these stem cells subjected to this differentiation.
Very nice talk. I have a question from a recent publication by Wolf and Dean. We can argue about the percentage of differentiation that you described, but he showed that there's increased differentiation regarding myocytes, increased number of secretory myocytes after MI. So how does that fit into your hypothesis? Because if the unfavorable milieu would prevent differentiation, then he should have seen it. Increase differentiation, not increase.
Yeah, I mean, it's not to say that it doesn't happen. It's why doesn't it happen more? There's going to be differentiation. Many studies, Jeff's study as well as others, have shown that if you injure the heart, you have more c-kit cells and differentiation. But if you look at chronic heart failure, you see it, at least from that study, you see a lot of these cells, and yet you see progression of remodel. It's not that there's not an impetus for repair, trying to repair the heart. It's just that why isn't it more, why doesn't it occur in a more with higher fidelity? That we think is related perhaps to these mediums.
Okay, thank you so much. We better move on since time is marching on. And if you didn't have the very latest version of the agenda, we're fortunate to have another speaker today. That's Josh here from the University of Miami, who will talk to us some about the CCTRN.
Thanks, Jay. It's really great to be here with you all. So I'll talk about work in the human model and largely what we've been doing in CCTRN. These are my disclosures. So basically, some of these thoughts might not be what you all are thinking. I would say that the use of cell therapy with culture-expanded cells and heart failure is a brand new field. The first paper was only published in 2011. I think there's this perception that the field of clinical trials is overwrought with poorly done studies. And I think those studies, what people are thinking about are studies with whole bone marrow experiments, which really aren't a cultured cell. It's a heterogeneous population of cells. And in an autologous setting, every patient is getting a completely different treatment. So what I'm referring to here are studies that have characterized culture-expanded cells, often allogeneic cells, so that there's a lot of reproducibility. I'll also argue that there's actually an emerging consensus around the potential clinical benefits for heart failure patients, mainly ischemic cardiomyopathy, with some of these culture-expanded cells, so much so that there are actually phase three trials being conducted now, which, if positive, will lead to the general availability of mesenchymal stem cells for the treatment of heart failure patients. But what we're really interested in at CCTRN and in my group is ways in which we can enhance the efficacy of current approaches. Here's the scar we've all been talking about. So it is a formidable problem. It's a 6 million Americans have this problem. That's 2% of the population. And so there's a huge opportunity here to help these patients, and that's what we're all been talking about today. And I argue along the lines of what many have said this morning is that to treat this, you need to remove the fibrosis. It needs to be replaced with perfused tissue, but that tissue also needs to be contractile so that there is a requirement for new cardiomyocytes, which can arise from a variety of different approaches that we're all aware of. So when I say there's a consensus, the consensus arises from a total of 256 patients, which are those of you who are used to phase three mega trials in cardiovascular medicine, that's incredibly minute. But from these 256 patients with different cells used, there is actually a consensus that this could work clinically to help patients. And it largely is through the reduction of the scar. The one thing that all of the studies show is that the amount of scar tissue is removed with the direct injection of these cultured cells in and around a scar, and that scar reduction is about on the order of 30 to 50%, so it's significant. The other thing that is clear is that people can walk farther on a 6-minute walk test and have a better score on a Minnesota Living with Heart Failure Questionnaire score, and those two together are usually predictive of a clinically beneficial treatment. So while we might not fully understand the mechanism, and we'll probably be studying the mechanism for the next several decades, it is making people better. And if this is borne out in phase three clinical trials, then we will be actually using the approaches that we have to treat patients. So how does this, what am I talking about exactly? So talking about the directed injection of cells into patients who have a ischemic cardiomyopathy due to a scar. And here's an example of how we do this with a BioCardia catheter. It's got a helical needle at its tip. So it could be inserted retrograde into the patient's heart. And you can localize where you want to inject in and around the scar. And in these experiments that we've done, we've tracked exactly where we've injected, as shown by the numbers on the chart there. We have largely relied on cardiac MRI imaging to look at the scar and then look at the contraction. So the upper panels are the contraction using tissue tagging. Red is abnormal, green is normal, and that corresponds to the area of scar. And what you can see in this example is that the contraction goes completely normal after a year, and that correlates with the reduction in scar by about 50%. So there is a reduction in scar, and there is a replacement with contractile tissue. These are culture-expanded bone marrow mesenchymal stem cells. Now, if we do that in a larger clinical trial, this is a 60-patient trial where patients are randomized to the mesenchymal stem cells, bone marrow mononuclear cells as a control or a placebo as a control, we replicate that finding with a randomized design. So there is, in the left panel, this is the reduction in scar tissue. The green is the mesenchymal stem cells. There's a 30% reduction. And the regional function also improves in that area. The green is the regional function as obtained by tissue tagging. So this appears to work in a small 60-patient study. Now, there really is morphological reduction in scar tissue, both in the amount of scar and its circumferential extent. So there's a reverse remodeling when you do this. So these mesenchymal stem cells injected in the area are degrading the collagen fibrils, and the replacement of that tissue is with contractile myocardium. So how does this work at the cellular level, and how did we take what we learned here to design a new trial? Well, we think it's at least in part related to the c-kit cells that we've heard about in Suman's talk. And I think everybody concurs that when you inject the mesenchymal stem cells, they don't stick around for a long time. And that's the whole issue about, is there paracrine signaling or what is it? And we, in our group, when we were doing these studies in pigs, we also didn't see the cells stick around for a long time. So we asked the question, what is occurring? And what is occurring is a marked upregulation of the c-kit cells. The red cells here are c-kit. But it's not just an upregulation of c-kit cells. There's also cell cycle activity that corresponds. So you see evidence of cell cycle activity. So I think these biological phenomena that we're aware can occur robustly in the neonatal period appear to be upregulated in the post-infarction heart and stimulated by the mesenchymal stem cells. So on the basis of that, we decided to do an experiment where a mixing experiment. We reasoned if the cells are working together, can we reduce that to practice as a therapeutic mixture by culture expanding the c-kit cells and the bone marrow cells and mixing them together. And when we did that, in an acute infarction model, we saw a twofold augmentation of the reduction in scar tissue. And this corresponded very nicely to a functional recovery. So if we did pressure volume loops, both the systolic and diastolic performance were normalized to a greater extent with the mixture than with either cell alone. So we thought we had enough information there for a clinical trial, but when we went to the FDA, they said, no, you don't. You did human cells into the pig with immunosuppression. We want you to do an autologous model in the pig that exactly replicates what you'd like to do in human beings. So here is that data. These are pigs now with a chronic infarct scar, so we waited 3 months for the scar to heal. We have obtained the cells from each individual animal, both by cardiac biopsy and bone marrow aspiration, culture expanded those cells, and done the experiment where we use the mesenchymal stem cells alone, shown in the green, or the combination with the cardiac c-kit cells. And what this data depicts, this was just published at JACC last fall, so it's out, is that whether or not you add the c-kit cells to the mesenchymal stem cells, you get a similar reduction in scar size of 40%. So this is different from the previous study, which was done in the acute infarction period. This is now the mature scar. And in the setting of the mature scar, the c-kit cells don't enhance the antifibrotic effect. But what they do is enhance the functional recovery. So if you look at ejection fraction, and there are a variety of other measures that we did in this work in using cardiac MRI, there's an enhancement of functional recovery with the mixture. The other thing I should also mention is it's incredibly safe. There's absolutely no arrhythmia or other unwanted side effects. So on the basis of this, the FDA did allow us to go ahead with the trial that the CCTRA is now doing, called the CONCERT-HF trial. Now, in order to do the trial, we have to first document that we can make the c-kit cells from an endomyocardial biopsy from the human who's had an infarct. And here, this is the proof of concept that we could do that. So it's a simple protocol where you collagenase, digest an endomyocardial biopsy, run it over a CD117 magnetic bead column, collect the cells, and then further culture expand them. Our target amount of cells is about 5 million, and we're able to achieve that. They retain, in our protocol, the c-kit positivity, and here are some examples of that. And this has enabled us to do the CONCERT-CHF trial, which has started last fall, and enrollment has really been extraordinarily good. We have a 16-patient run-in phase, followed by 144 randomized studies. So this study will be almost as big as the totality of the world's evidence in those six papers, except for the TEVA trial, which is one of those phase three trials I alluded to. We enrolled the 16 run-in patients in about 2 months. So they're all enrolled and will be treated. The first patient will be treated very soon, and you could just see the design moving. These are the centers.
the seven centers that are participating in this, and we're doing all of the cell processing at the University of Miami. So that is, I have more to say, but in the interest of time, I think I'll just stop there and see if there are any questions. So bottom line is, trial is progressing, and I expect that in the next 2 to 3 years, we'll have very substantial amounts of new clinical data to help us decipher the mechanisms and the uses of these new approaches for patients. Thank you.
Thanks, Josh. So time is tight. We have time for one quick question and quick answer.
So a change in viability can happen by increasing myocardial mass, which might not be directly related to number of myocytes, but to volume of myocytes. So, you know, for example, like with the Cardiosphere trial show, there's no change in the aspect of the change in increasing scaffold rate, increasing viable tissue. But it's unclear whether this is due to increase in local hypertrophy or peri-infarct hypertrophy, which will give you the same results. So in the absence of EF, how do you think the weight of viability as disease confirmation play into the memory?
Boy, it's always complicated to go from a mouse model to a human model. We rely heavily on the pig to sort of be an intermediary in that. In the pig model, we clearly see myocyte division, cell cycle activity. We measure the myocytes, they're smaller rather than larger. So it's really impossible to know at this point all of the mechanisms. I think it's multifactorial. But what we can see very nicely is the net effect, which is a reduction in scar and with a replacement in contractile tissue. So as I said before, there are lots of gaps that have to be filled in, but I think that's part of the course for any new field. You've got to start with something that you know that's working, and then work your way back often to understand the mechanism. And I think we have that. I think the evidence that supports that this approach is working is pretty compelling at this stage.
Well, following up on what Rick had proposed, do you think that this is more of a paracrine effect, or do you think that it's the cells that are sticking around in these large animal models and maybe the humans that might contribute to remuscularization? Do you think it's principally paracrine, exosomes, or mirrors, whatever it is, that's promoting these changes in the scar formation and prompting cells to re-enter the cell cycle?
I think it's both. And I think, as you can see, all of the things that have been mentioned this morning, there's so many different factors. I think we always want to distill things down and put them in neat little boxes. And I think if you look at the definition of the word paracrine, it's the wrong word for what the cells are doing in any event. It's not releasing a single factor that's having a remote effect in a close-by region. These cells are releasing an enormous amount of substances. They are responding to the MLU. They're responding to the inflammatory environment. They are releasing exosomes and mirrors for sure. And all of those things together are contributing to a healing phenomenon. So I think we've got decades of work ahead of us to understand the mechanism of action, along with, fortunately, the clinical trials that are being conducted, so that we can at least use this safe therapy as we understand its mechanism. But I think calling it paracrine is the wrong terminology, because it's so multifaceted in terms of what the cells are releasing. That they are having some effects themselves. They do stick around long enough. I didn't go into that, but we have a lot of data. There certainly is a presence of the cells that, if you eradicate, reduces the effect that they have.
Or we redefine the concept of paracrine effects.
Right. I think we need a new word.
Yeah.
Like we came up with paracrine when endocrine didn't.
We'll put in the starting sentence for the paper we put together.
Right,
so
okay.
We are coming to running out. We have no break. We have to go to the public meeting immediately. And I'm so proud of the group be part of that. And I'm so happy. Let's have no break. And you take your break individually and go to the public session now, 11 o'clock.
Except for the group photo that's going to be on that wall, the other side of the wall, as you file.
Even imagine that we can fabricate the patient-specific myocardial tissue equivalent in the petri dish. Now everybody can do it. And we are competing for the PCTC for the next 7 years. And whoever the lucky one will get that, probably there will be two in the room. Hopefully we'll get it. But one way or another, we all benefit from this NIH PCBC consortium, now become a PCTC. We'll emphasize the translational perspective. So we will have a very busy day today, so I will have my great pleasure to introduce our Dean Dr. Yuwan Alexander to have an opening remark.
Well, good morning. I'm Yuwan Alexander. I have the pleasure of being the Dean of Engineering at UAB. And on behalf of the University and the School of Engineering, I'm very pleased to welcome you here to the NIH Progenitor Cell Biology Consortium's Cardiovascular Tissue Engineering Symposium, or the PCBC-CVTE, as I was told earlier this morning. I'm also very pleased, and I want to really highlight this, to have Jay Zhang here with us as the leader of our BME department. And Jay and I have had many discussions about exciting and impactful things that you do, the people in this room. And in particular, how about the convergence of disciplines that facilitate integration of life sciences, medicine, engineering, physical sciences, as it says in this recent National Research Council report, beyond, how that facilitates the acceleration of new ideas, not only from the lab into textbooks and papers, but also into actual practice, which in the area you work in has true impact. And certainly through your collective efforts, you've shown that progress in your field is largely being made in interfaces between cardiology, stem cell science, and bioengineering, and that there's a need for convergence through transdisciplinary research and training to pioneer new discovery and accelerate implementation and application of the results of your good work. And so you see here, we have at the top left corner a piece from the University of Louisville's Engineering School where they're 3D printing a plastic part. And I know there's many of you in here would rather see that was made of real biological tissue. And certainly I'm waiting with great anticipation to see the translations of those thoughts and ideas that are in your minds today to actual practice. And so please converge here today. And I await some exciting outcomes of your deliberations and findings and propositions for future work. Thank you and welcome.
A structure that I've studied for 25 years, and I'll focus on that. There we go. Oh yeah, here's a disclosure. I'm an inventor on patents assigned to Stanford University on the subject of this talk. So if you take one thing away from my talk today, please let it be this slide. And what this slide demonstrates is a new concept that we've introduced into the field, and that is the concept of transflammation. That activation of innate immunity activates signaling pathways that are well known that result in the release of inflammatory cytokines and chemokines. What we've learned is that same pathway also results in changes in epigenetic modifiers, changes in gene expression, changes in the activity of epigenetic modifiers that puts the chromatin from a closed conformation into a more open conformation so that transcriptional factors can access genes and activate them. So we discovered this process when we were trying to induce pluripotency and in cells using cell permeant peptides and failed to do so. So let me tell you about that study. But first, let me reintroduce to you Shinya Yamanaka. And I think most of you know of this man. He published his first paper on induction of pluripotency, the induced pluripotent stem cells, in 2006. He actually also, in the same year, he filed his patent on the induction of pluripotency, and then wins the Nobel Prize 6 years later. That's a land speed record for winning the Nobel Prize. And it's because these iPSCs are already affecting medicine in beneficial ways, and regenerative medicine particularly. So Yamanaka used four factors, OCT4, SOX2, KLF4, c-MYC. He found that these four factors, when forcibly expressed using a retroviral vector in fibroblasts, could turn some of these fibroblasts into iPSCs. Now, the iPSCs are like embryonic stem cells. Induced pluripotent stem cells can become endoderm, ectoderm, mesoderm, and these iPSCs can be used to differentiate whatever your cell is of interest is and do some disease modeling or do high-throughput screening or perhaps even therapy. So with regard to that, I'm a physician scientist. The therapy that I'm interested in would be directed at the endothelium. The endothelium is this diaphanous film of tissue that invests all of our blood vessels. It exerts tremendous control over vascular smooth muscle tone, the interaction of a blood vessel with circulating blood elements, and vasodilation, and vascular smooth muscle cell proliferation. I do believe in this adage that one is as old as one's endothelium. If your endothelium is healthy, you have to generally have a healthy cardiovascular status. And that adage comes from Dr. Rudolf Altschul in 1954. Although Thomas Sydenham said back in the 1600s that a man is as old as his arteries. So it's been a concept that's been around for quite a long time. So anyway, we're generating endothelial cells from iPSCs. Jack Wong is a junior faculty member with me. And when he was a postdoc with me at Stanford, we developed methods to take iPSCs and generate endothelial cells. These iPSC-derived endothelial cells look very similar to normal endothelial cells. They express all the surface markers you'd want to expect to see. They functionally behave like endothelial cells, forming vascular networks in Matrigel. And we also showed the improved perfusion in animal models of ischemia. If you put them, the human cells into Matrigel, human iPS-derived endothelial cells into Matrigel, inject that subcutaneously into a immunodeficient mouse, you see self-assembly of capillary networks and circulating within those human capillaries is murine red blood cells. So these capillaries actually form functional anastomoses with the mouse vasculature. And as I mentioned, we've used the Heinlein ischemia model to show that these cells can actually improve capillary density in ischemic hind limb when injected into the mouse hind limb, and they can improve perfusion. These effects are due to paracrine effects, if you excuse me saying that, Josh. Paracrine effects because the cells don't persist very long, as shown by luciferase studies. We do know that they make angiogenic cytokines in response to hypoxia, so it is assumed that they are releasing angiogenic factors that enhance the microvascular density of the mouse. And what we see, in fact, in functional studies Nan Wong did with me at Stanford, that iPSC-derived endothelial cells improve perfusion more so than the parental fibroblasts or physiologic saline solution when injected into the ischemic hind limb of the mouse. There's a modest improvement in the perfusion. So having done that, we were interested actually in thinking about this in terms of therapy. How could we use our iPS-derived endothelial cells clinically, making conduits or injecting them into ischemic regions? But the problem is that at the time we were using retroviral vectors like a lot of other people, and we wanted to use a non-integrating strategy. So we used cell permeant peptides of the Yamanaka factors, and William Yang of Jim Schwartz's laboratory helped us in generating these OCK4, SOX2, KL4, c-MYC proteins with a little R9 sequence for cell membrane transduction. And it's known, Paul Wender showed at Stanford quite some years ago, that polyarginine is able to drag whatever you're interested in through the cytoplasmic membrane by mechanisms not yet well understood. But we made these hybrid proteins, and we showed, Jun Lee in the lab showed that they could bind to their consensus sequence, and Johannes Gabrielium showed that they could find their way into the cell. And it was Arwen Hunter's task to find the right dose and duration of these cell permeant peptides to get iPSCs. Well, the whole experiment failed because we couldn't find the right dose. We tried everything. We tried different timing. And poor Arwen Hunter banged her head against the wall for about 9 months while we were trying to do this. And then that led to a cell paper because Jun and Nazish showed that that the cell permeant peptides weren't working because they weren't activating toll-like receptor, pattern recognition receptor, which was absolutely required for the alteration in epigenetic modifiers, as I mentioned to you. So OCK4, SOX2, KL4, c-MYC, these provide directionality of the transcriptional machinery, but you need to have access to the chromosome, and the histone proteins need to be modified so that you have transcriptional access. So the key experiment actually was done by Jun Lee. She was trying to understand why the cell permeant peptides weren't working. And what she did is to compare retroviral SOX2 to cell permeant SOX2. And she looked downstream at the core pluripotency network. I'm just showing you one. I'm showing you NANOG. This pattern was true of all the downstream genes that we examined downstream of the Yamanaka factors. So with retroviral SOX2, we get an immediate increase at day one in NANOG expression. It continues to go up, whereas cell permeant SOX2 does nothing. And so that was interesting. It made some explanation for why we weren't seeing an effect. Nazish showed the same thing with cell permeant OCK4. So it's always nice when two postdocs get the same data. And then Nazish carried it out a little bit farther to 21 days, and cell permeant peptides were just not giving us the same activation of the core pluripotency network. And the idea occurred to me that maybe the retroviral vector itself was having an effect, and I asked them to put in a retroviral GFP with the cell permeant peptides, and then everything worked. So the retrovirus was having some effect that the cell permeant peptides, the Yamanaka factors, the true transcriptional proteins themselves were not having. And because we're short on time, I'll just say that what we worked out was that activation of innate immunity was critical in this process. And you know, we knocked out various pattern recognition receptors and the downstream elements of those pattern recognition receptors that could recognize double-stranded viral RNA. Toll-like receptor 3 is dedicated to that purpose of recognizing viral a double-stranded RNA, and knocking out TLR3 and elements in its pathway could alter the reprogramming. So here you see iPSC colonies 30 days after giving Yamanaka factors to fibroblasts, and in these Mighty 88 knockdown, there was no effect, but knocking out the TLR3 pathway impaired reprogramming. And we went down and knocked out other elements in the pathway. And to make a long story short, we showed that activation of innate immunity could enhance dox-inducible MEF production of iPSCs, whereas a knockdown of NF-kappa B reduced colony formation. So the idea here is that activation of innate immunity causes the chromatin to assume this more open state. And I don't have time to go into detail, but we found that the whole HDAC family is downregulated. The histone acetyltransferase family members are upregulated. That alone would put the chromatin into more of an open probability state, and that is necessary for this epigenetic plasticity. The Yamanaka factors alone are not sufficient. You need this increase in epigenetic plasticity. And we have more recently shown, not published, but we've more recently shown that reactive oxygen species, reactive nitrogen species are playing a role in this process by modifying the epigenetic modifiers, nitrosylating, for example, ring one, so that the PRC complex falls apart and there's less repression. So we call that process transformation. And I'll just skip through this very briefly. How much time do I have, Tim? Tim, no time. Okay, I guess I'm done. But we applied this to transderm differentiation of fibroblast endothelial cells, and we can, by activating innate immunity, we can put the chromatin into an open configuration and get endothelial cells. So thank you for your attention.
Time for a couple of short questions. Anybody?
That's a great talk, a very important discovery. Would you speculate how this important mechanistic finding can benefit or guide the clinical trials of therapy we talked earlier?
I think this phenomenon is important in regeneration. I think we need to know how much innate immune activation is necessary for this epigenetic plasticity and how much is too much. Because we do find that overactivation of innate immunity can actually have an impairment, cause an impairment of epigenetic plasticity.
Other questions? We have time for one more question. We stopped John so we could answer questions.
Hi, Corrine Cologne, Brown University. What's the impact then of using the xenotransplants. So in an immune-compromised animal where the immunity is really, compromised and you can put human cells in, how does that affect this regeneration?
Well, that's a good question. I would point out, though, that in those immunodeficient mice, aspects of innate immunity are still apparent. For example, fibroblasts in an immunodeficient animal can still respond to pathogen-associated molecular patterns or damage-associated molecular patterns. You've knocked out adaptive immunity, but many of the elements of innate immunity are still intact.
Thank you, Tim. And I, too, want to extend my thanks to Jay for organizing a terrific symposium. I'm going to continue along the same theme as John, and I'm going to give a very short story in our efforts of a different approach aimed at regenerative medicine. And as all of you know, heart failure is a devastating disease, and really the only curative therapy for advanced heart failure is orthotopic heart transplantation. And it's estimated that more than 100,000 patients could benefit from such therapy, but we reduce that number down to about 6,000 patients each year. So the number of patients that actually get such therapy is about 2% of those that actually need it. And so one of the strategies to enhance this pool of donor organs would be to engineer alternative organs. And I think with the emerging technologies, this now becomes a possibility. And I'd like to just highlight our non-published or unpublished studies currently aimed at this ultimate goal. And of course, it really begins at the endothelium, because any kind of xenotransplant, the first thing that that recipient sees is the endothelium. And so it's our goal is to modify that endothelium. And so our previous studies, as I said in our workshop, has really been aimed at deciphering the cues and the networks that govern fate specification, especially those focused on the mesodermal derivatives, that is the cardiomyocyte, the endothelium, and the blood. And today I'm just going to give you a short story of our studies in, of a gene that we discovered, ETV2, that is partially regulated by NKX2.5. Now, ETV2, we've shown, is a master regulator for the hematoendothelial lineages. That is, if you force overexpression of ETV2, you can form endothelium and you can form blood. And shown here, if one undertakes a gene disruption strategy to produce embryos, mouse embryos that are that globally have deletion of ETV2, you can see in contrast to the wild type littermate, which has endocardium and endothelium, these lineages are completely absent in the ETV2 null, and these embryos are non-viable by E9.5. And so we